welcome to a Kelly and Wrighty run-in special. So how are you feeling with 10 games to go until the end of the season and a certain team from North London at the very top?
I'm feeling good and a little nervous, but feeling good, Kelly.
Yeah, but the nerves do kick in as well. Yes, and it is set to be one of the greatest title races in history. Just a point between the top three. Will Arsenal claim their first crown since the Invincibles? No quadruple now for Liverpool, but is a title triumph written in the stars in Klopp's farewell seasons? Or could Man City win an unprecedented double treble and City up against Arsenal in their next game?
Yes, they are. The race for a top four spot could be going down to the wire as well. Aston Villa lead the way after Tottenham will be beaten 3-0 at Fulham, but will Manchester United in sixth place be the ones who make a late charge?
And the fight to stay up isn't for the faint-hearted either. Luton's dramatic late point against Nottingham Forest and Burnley's first win of the year against Brentford has changed the look of the battle to beat the drop. Could it all go down to the final day? How much are you looking forward to this season finale?
I can't wait, girls. I can't lie. The running. Bring on the running.
It all comes down to this. Three teams, one point between them. A title race for the ages.
The end starts here, where pressure shapes legend.
I will love it if we beat them. I will love it. Love it.
Own the moment. Or let it slip. Everyone has a part to play. They just don't know what it is yet. Shape destiny. Write history.
Record breaker.
Beat the drop. Reach for Europe. Race to the title. This is the Premier League. This is the run-in.
Oh, it's so exciting as we head into the final 10 games of the season. Darren Lewis is here, Rachel Corsi is here, and we've got an extra spot that's being occupied by Michael Owen, who's come in as a special guest because we've got so much to look forward to. We're going to look at the title race, we're going to look at the battle for the Champions League places, could be four, could be five of them, and we're going to take a look at the battle to stay in the Premier League. It's all to be decided. And do you know what? The title is Arsenal's to lose, right?
Kels, you're so mean. The thing is, Kels, is that, like I said
better
in the intro...
Better that way, though, isn't it?
Yeah. Like you said in the intro, you know what I mean? It's ours to lose. But the fact is that I'm nervous, I said in the intro, simply because it's great to be in a position where you're going for something. The players need to be. For me, Arsenal players need to be in this environment. If they're doing what they want to do, the progression they're making, where they want to be at the top end, they have to get used to being in this. The fans, it's all right for the fans to be nervous and the players, but they have to be able to perform once they get there. But that's why, Kels, it is ours to lose, you know, being in the top and everything. But at the same time, it's very, very exciting for our team.
Yeah, three teams separated by just one point. It's so close. It's never been this close at this stage of the Premier League season. And it's almost as if you can't just see off one of your challengers. There's someone else you've got to keep an eye out for.
And you can't split them. You know, I've been looking at the run-ins, you know, all week, and even them, you're sort of thinking, oh, who's got the easiest, who's got the hardest? Of course, this next game, Manchester City against Arsenal, is going to be absolutely huge. So Liverpool are the ones that will be sitting back on their sofas, looking forward to that one, hoping there's probably 4 points dropped as opposed to three. I guess they'll be wanting a draw. But, I'm sure we'll go into predictions after. We'll probably all think, different, you know, it's everyone you speak to has got a different view of this running.
It is so hard to call, particularly when we're going to ask you guys to make those calls before that game between... I know, well, you can just bluff it. Just say, I want Arsenal to win it. My heart says Arsenal. There's your answer. Spoiler. But look, before that game between Manchester City and Arsenal, it's really hard to decide because that is going to be crucial in terms of where the title ends up. You don't think so?
I'm going to disagree. There's so many more games still to play. And, yeah, they're playing each other, so someone's going to lose points, of course, both potentially. But I still think 10 games is, you know, there's so many possible ways this can go. And I don't think this one game needs to mean that. I also think the fact it comes after the international break, from a fan's point of view, is a little bit disappointing because I know what it's like as a player. You come back from an international break, it's so difficult to quickly... transition back into that team mode. I think it takes away from both teams. I don't think we're going to see the best of either team. You can't possibly, because everyone's been away, you're coming back in it. Yeah, both teams will be right up for it and you'll be getting stuck in, It'll be a great game. I'm not going to say, though, the outcome of this is not going to define it. I still think there's so much movement. I think there's a lot of change still.
I think, Dee, that it comes down to navigating this stage of it. Like, City going into games of this calibre know how to deal with this. And this is what I was saying about Arsenal. They have to learn these things because they have to beat City. For me, they have to beat City.
I agree. And I think the big thing for Arsenal is City are near invincible at home. We go back to November 2022 for the last time they were beaten at home. The numbers are all in Arsenal's favour. Best defence, they've scored the most goals. They've scored the most goals from set pieces. They've scored the most goal in the final 15 minutes of games. So all of the numbers go in their favour and actually make them favourites, you have, would have to say.
But if they don't win, it's
absolutely.
They don't have to be City.
No.
You know, if you say that and then they don't beat them, then it's
And
like,
that's exactly the point I was about to make. If you look at last season, the teams you slipped up against were West Ham and Southampton.
Yeah.
Not the big teams. So in that regard, that it's a very fair point. I think... For us in media and journalism, and it's fantastic because you've got three teams. And lots of people said last season, Arsenal can't win the title. They'd kind of dismissed them because they'd have to be ahead of Liverpool and City. But obviously, they've proven they can do that. They've impressed in terms of recruitment. And they've learned that particular lesson. They've learned the lesson of organisation. They've learned that you don't have to be pretty and score fours and fives if you can keep clean sheets. And... I would be very surprised over the next week or so if we don't see lots of pullouts from the big teams from this international break. For the very reason you said, I think these games after the international break are so big, so crucial. Liverpool have to beat Brighton at home. Have to.
You see, there's games now they have to win.
They have to.
That's why I believe, like, obviously, if you can beat City, it gives you so much confidence and momentum, but at the same time, probably the main thing is to not lose to them, but if you can beat them, the confidence and momentum that gives you to go on to beat the other teams, because there's other teams, you know, the Villa of this world, Man United, even we saw what Man United done in the FA Cup, how they can be so... look how many goals they can score, as much as they can see them. The main thing, I believe, for us now, for our young team, is to go there and believe you can beat them, because you're going to have to beat the rest, because I believe that City, when they haven't lost at home, they can beat everybody. You feel like they can beat everybody. They step it up.
Joe, I just wonder, you look at that, and there is an argument that Liverpool have the more straightforward of the three run-ins, that there are maybe fewer of those really difficult games coming up. But I don't know whether that's necessarily at this stage of the season a benefit. I wonder if sometimes you want to have those big games coming up because it helps with the focus at a time of the season where players are maybe just... dipping a bit in energy, they're looking for that extra spark.
I think you're right, because I think if you look at, for example, the defeat to Manchester United in the FA Cup, that was Liverpool's fifth game in 16 games. And the energy seemed to be kind of just seeping out of them towards the end of that game in terms of ideas, in terms of decision-making. It was their 18th game in 2024. So... the workload is big. I mean, obviously, you've got the young players who are coming through and doing very well, Conor Bradley and all the rest of them. But as you say, really, if you've got the bigger games, then you don't start to feel tired because you have that
energy.
You guys know better than
me. Only thing is that they are massive games, aren't they? If it was at the start of the season, I get it. But when you're going for the title, I think you want... I'd want the lesser team. I'd want Liverpool's running ahead of everyone else's. But I am interested in terms of... the old analogy that we've always been brought up thinking is the best team always wins the Premier League. The best team always wins the league. We always get told it. Well, if somebody wins it this year on goal different or by 1 point, are we saying that they're the best team? Like, who are the best team? It doesn't... I don't necessarily think the best team are going to win it this year. It might not
Who do you think
happen.
The best team are?
I think the best team are Manchester City. But I don't... you know,
Performance-wise...
I just think they're the best team.
Do you mean the best team to watch?
To watch, or the best team because they just got the players and everything. In performance, are you saying that?
I think the most exciting team to watch are probably Liverpool. But I think the best team, I mean, they've proven it for years and years now. I think it's Manchester City. But it's not necessarily going to be the best team that will win the league. It might be Arsenal. It might be Liverpool. It might be Man City. But we're always getting told it's always the best team. It might not necessarily be the case this year.
Although, if you're looking at Arsenal, and they do have the best defence, that they do have this goal-scoring record, And you look. And you look.
You're so smug.
No, I'm just no. We're dealing with facts. We're dealing with facts here.
Well, the facts before. We're dealing with facts before. All these things that you mentioned. Yeah. But that doesn't mean that Arsenal go to Manchester City as favourite.
No, but what? And Manchester City, in fact, are the like Opta predicting that Manchester City are the most likely to win the title, and presumably they're factoring in heavily what happens in that game at the Etihad. Mm. But what I was going to say about Arsenal, if Arsenal were to go on and win it, one of the metrics you can look at as well is how they've performed against the teams around them, and they have been the better team against Liverpool and Manchester City, and there's an opportunity to build on that in the game at the Etihad. So there's an argument that they've earned it in that sense.
Yeah, and the thing is that when you look at that, the problem that Arsenal had is that you said they can lose to those teams. Those teams that we saw, like the Southamptons and things like that, coming to, with all due respect to Southampton.
But so it was the draws, wasn't it? The West Ham, yes. Southampton, but and on the back of the Chelsea.
I think that what they've done this season, they've done a very good job of beating those teams very, very convincingly. Now, if you can beat Man City, then that kind of gives you the confidence, I say, to go into these games knowing we can and we should beating this team. Those are the reasons why you have to go somewhere like City and beat them, because you've shown that you can beat the teams around you. So if you can beat City, then it's definitely in your hands, because you know that you beat everyone else, you're probably going to keep them away from you.
That's incredible when you look at that. Given where the teams are in the table, how close they are, is the fact that Arsenal have got two wins, and they're the only team to beat one of those teams inside the top three. When you think about where the teams are, that's surprising.
It is, in a way, and you look at it and you think, well, if they're beating the big teams, then are they the best team? And I'd definitely say they're the most efficient team at the moment. I mean, they don't look like conceding when they've beaten those teams. I mean, they've been really impressive and hardly surrendered any chances, let alone goals. So I think, Arsenal are a serious threat. They were a serious threat last season. But as Wrighty mentioned earlier, it was important for them to step forward. It's important for them to be involved in another title race or Champions League race or whatever it might be, just for this young team to then gain the experience. But they're the team, when you look at, if you said to me who's going to win the league in a couple of years, well, I'd probably think that obviously Jurgen Klopp's going to have left. I can't imagine Pep Guardiola's going to be there for much longer. And you've got to have massive... They're playing at their elite at the moment. Man City and Liverpool are playing at their absolute elite, and all the cards are in their favour. That's exactly... But soon, their managers are going to leave. And I just think that Arsenal are... That they're the team. If you said who's going to be at the top in 2 years, I think they're probably the safer bet, because they're on the trajectory.
So that's really interesting into how much that plays into it, because obviously with Arsenal there's a sense of this being the beginning of something. Manchester City very much in the middle of it and right at the peak of their powers. But for Liverpool it feels like this is the last chance under Jurgen Klopp, and even though there are those young players coming through, it does feel like a last opportunity before that huge change comes in.
Yeah, and I think there's a little element of the fact we know he's going to leave, almost think that's intentional that it's come out so early, so it gives you that little extra fuel. And you kind of get that feel-good factor around it. You think, oh, we have to do it for Jurgen. I love that point Michael just made about the fact that when you look at the teams and the trajectory they're going, it does feel like Arsenal are that team. And if you were to say, you know, what capacity are they operating at, you do feel they've got another 10, 20, 30% still to come in the years ahead. I think it's massively benefited Arsenal. They've probably not been at the very top up until now. I think we saw how heavy a burden that was for the players last year from the get-go, and maybe took its toll in the end. I feel at the moment that Arsenal are the best team to watch. I think they've earned the right to be called the team that looks, you know, to be the one that's performing at the best, and the stats back that up. But equally, Liverpool are a huge club, huge team. Man City, we know they've got that relentlessness. Mm. So
The other thing, the only thing I'd add to that is that, have City got more gears? How many times have we seen this team, you know, just the last 10, 15 games, go and win the Champions League, go and win the Premier League, not losing, literally win every game?
Well, exactly why I say Arsenal have to win every game. They have to beat them, because
City are full throttle at the moment, Arsenal. Well, that's why I think, maybe Liverpool and Arsenal are full throttle,
whereas I think so.
City are just...
You can feel like they can go again. Absolutely they can. They can not lose any games.
Yeah, but the only thing you could... I mean, again, this is why it's such a fascinating title running, because We thought that a few weeks ago about Manchester City, and then they dropped points against Chelsea. Then you look maybe at the performance against Liverpool, where they didn't seem to be in that end-of-season zone we normally see them in. So if they are going to kick in, they're leaving it later than maybe they traditionally would.
And plus, remember that they're experienced. They're not playing as well as we've seen Manchester City play, but they're still getting it done. And they're conceding more goals. I think that's what's happening this season with Man City, is that you can see that you can get at them. Yeah. I think it's 28 goals in 28 games. So something they've conceded, which is so much more. I think it's 2016, 17, the last time they conceded that kind of goal. So you know that they're there, and there's something happening with City where you can get at them. And this is why an Arsenal or a Liverpool or even a Brentford, if you go there and you're organised enough and you can take the chances, you've got a chance at City. And that is where I think Arsenal, or anybody who's playing them at the moment, City, you've got to be ruthless in those moments.
I mean, I'd be interested to see the way that Arsenal approach the game at City, because do they try to nullify Rodri, who is that one constant in all the games that they've won this season? Mm. He is the driving force behind it. Or do they try to play their own game and impose themselves on City, given that there are so many players in the Arsenal team who are prepared to take responsibility? They can score goals, they can create goals. How do you approach a game like that?
I think Arteta will be trying to make City worry about them a bit more.
Absolutely.
I think in the past, you know, when you play City, you do probably put more focus on them because you have to. But I think Arsenal at a point now where Arteta maybe thinks, can I make Pep just think about a few things here that we can do that, that maybe, you know, normally Man City do probably have the luxury of only being able to, of just focusing on what they can do. Yeah. But I think now there's a little more cat and mouse in it.
Yeah, and if they can keep it tight, Arsenal, we know how good they've been defensively so far this season. They have that ability from set pieces, although we saw in the goal Manchester City scored against Liverpool, they're not too shabby at that either. Yeah. If anything's going to trip Arsenal up, I don't want to play into like your superstitions here, but if anything's going to trip Arsenal up, what will it be in the running?
Well, it will be, again, if they slip back into... It's a mentality thing now, because they've got the numbers to back themselves up with the defensive record and the goal scoring that they're doing. So it's down to mentality now and you know, getting it done. I think that's the only thing. If they lapse in concentration, like, for instance, like I said, they have to go and beat Man City, I think that would be a major feather in their cap if they can beat Man City, because it would then give them the confidence to go and beat anybody else. And not saying beat them off the park with unbelievable football, but get the job done. Mm. And I think that the only thing that can stop them now is if they have a mentality slip, if something like that happens.
I agree. Just to add to that, I wonder if... City are very, very good at shutting out the noise, shutting out the newspapers, shutting out the radio, the TV. Liverpool are very good at doing that as well. Arsenal, when they were trying to get top four two seasons ago, and they just slipped up at the end. And then last season, they slipped up towards the end because the noise and the romance around them winning the title started to really build, and the neutrals are on their, were in their camp, if you like. And now there is a subplot of the apprentice maybe pulling one over on the master as well. You've got all these players who are finally looking as though they're going to do it. And I actually think it's going to be about whether or not they can shut the noise out as it gets closer and closer.
I wonder, you look at Arsenal this season, and yes, there's been criticism of their celebrations, and they do really embrace the emotion of those big games. I wonder if they've maybe gone in the opposite direction. Rather than try to shut it out, they've done a little bit like what Liverpool did when they were going toe-to-toe with City, and harness that and try and use it as a positive. I don't know. What do you think?
I think so as well, because the reason being something that you said, Wrighty, earlier about the fact that they are chalking off those wins against teams that have slipped up against in the past, the kind of team like Southampton and West Ham that cost them last season. This time around, they're saying, we're beating these guys. And if somebody wants to say anything about us celebrating it, let them.
Yeah.
But we want to generate a culture of winning within the dressing room that says this is what we do.
Yeah.
And this is what we want to embrace and celebrate. And we want our fans to get behind it as well. And when you go to the Emirates now, there is that belief that they can find a way to win in difficult circumstances.
That's what it comes down to, Kells, again. It comes down to the belief, because everybody says that it's Arsenal's lack of experience at this stage of the season when you're trying to win it, what can cost them. And now we're in it. Everybody's fit. You've got a few more people to come back, obviously. Tomiyasu and Timber as well. You know, Thomas Partey, Fabio Vieira, but not so much them two. But Arsenal are nearly at the best team that they can put out there. So, you know, it's coming down to now just getting the job done. Mm.
If City are going to fall short, and I know they're a point off, but I mean, that is neither here nor there. With 10 games to go, as you say, to the end of the season. If City are going to drop off, what are their weaknesses? What could be the thing that costs them, do you think, come the end of the season? Because I know you're saying they're the best team in the league, but might not win it. So if they don't, what could it be?
Well, for me, sorry, Michael. Come on, Mike.
It's very hard to say. I mean, lots of things could happen. You might say, they've taken it too late now, because anybody can. We've just seen the graphic there. Arsenal have won 8 games on the spin. Yeah. Anybody can do that now. So one slip up. I know we're saying there's lots of points and lots of games to go, but when these teams get focused, you look at the history of the Premier League, look at the last few years, when there's a head-to-head going towards the last 10 games of the season, there's not many slip-ups. Mm. There's not many. Mm. And, I mean, remember Manchester City, Liverpool a few years ago, they literally won 12 out of 12, both of them, to finish. It was insane what was happening. And I just think that these teams are so good at the moment. They're so good. This is... Have we ever seen 3 teams this good in the Premier League at once? I mean, probably not. Mm-mm. And I'm not sure they're going to slip up that many times. They might, but I just think that City, they've got form of doing this. They've got form of finishing strong. They've got form of playing in big games, of winning big games at the end of the season. And you have to question it for a team like Arsenal, not done it before, not in a long time. They have obviously won their last 8, but the pressure's only going to crank up. And there'll be a lot of noise, as Darren says, from outside. Mm. So they've got less questions to ask.
You know, the thing is, Kels, we know that Manchester City can win the next 10 games. And that's why I go back to saying it again, why Arsenal have to win. Because if Arsenal...
That would be 18 wins in a row for Arsenal if they win their next 10.
That's a massive, massive ask. But you cannot look at this City side and not say, like Michael rightly says, they can go again. You know, with I know they're conceding. But with Arsenal have to win that game simply because they know that City can win all of their games. So if Arsenal lose that game, then City are going to they're going to be able to win those games. We don't know if Arsenal can do that. Like you rightly said, that would mean 18 games on the spin they're going to have to win. It's something they'll be setting a new precedent for themselves. They know that City can do that. Mm. And Arsenal, for me, if I'm in the dressing room, we have to be winning every single game from here on in. You have to.
Michael, I want to ask you about Liverpool as well, because obviously with City and Arsenal facing up next time when the Premier League resumes, there's going to be all the focus on them and what that can do to the title race. In the meantime, Liverpool, as Darren said, have got a big game against Brighton, which is not necessarily going to be straightforward. And now the pressure is on them. They went out of the FA Cup to Manchester United. That's going to sting. But maybe more worryingly were some of the signs from their performance in that game. Is that something that would concern you as we head into the run-in for them?
I mean, I've been so impressed with it. I think Liverpool had a lot of questions at the start of the season. I was questioned. It's a total new midfield. There's not one player that starts regularly, let's say. Maybe you could say, oh, Harvey Elliott plays a little bit, or Curtis Jones plays a little bit. But really, it was a total new look of a midfield. That attacking phase as well, the attacking positions, that's changed a lot over the recent years. So it was only the back four, really, and the goalkeeper that stayed the same at the start of the season, and Mo Salah. But lots of other players have come in the last season or two. So I thought this could be a little bit transitionally type of... And remember what happened last season. I mean, there was a very average season last season. So to bounce back with a totally, you know, half a new team is incredible. And if you speak to Liverpool fans, they'll say, certainly the first half of the season, they weren't playing that well, but incredibly getting some great results. Now they're starting to play well as well. And, of course, there was a reverse at Old Trafford the other day. And you could say, you know, it was quite an emotional game. They made a lot of mistakes. But, again, they've been here before. A lot of these players have seen it, done it. The manager has. The fans know what it feels like. So, you know, really impressed with Liverpool this season. And, again, not many questions to answer.
You know, when you look at... Liverpool's midfield now with Endo, I think he's literally playing such good... he's putting in such good performances. It's actually freeing up McAllister to play how he's playing. I think when you look at who's coming back, Alisson's going to be coming back, Trent's going to be coming back, Jota's going to be coming back. I think for Jurgen Klopp to get to this level, this stage of the season, with the players that he's had missing, and they're still amongst it with the way he's used those kids and everybody to get it done, I think that Liverpool are very, very much still, for me, easily one of the favourites in respect of, like you rightly said, Mike, they know how to navigate the season. They've got a lot of experience in the team. And I think that it's been unbelievable. So the international break for Liverpool to get those players back will almost, especially with that loss to Man United, I think, you know, and with all the emotion that's around it, they'll want to make sure that they finish this really well. And I think that it'll be a really good time for them, this break.
Having set up how close this is going to be and how difficult to call, let's timestamp this. We have 10 games left to play. Manchester City and Arsenal have still to play each other, so that's yet to be decided. That's going to be a big factor. Mm. But if you had to call it right now, what would you say?
Michael, can't you hear Michael. Kelly talking to you? She's looking straight at you.
Well, you're going to... Well, let's take it as read you're going to say Arsenal. Because you
no,
want it
you know
to be
what Arsenal. It is that I think that Arsenal being top, the goal difference you can see there, and again, I'd say that's why they have to beat City, because I think they're going to have to win all the games now, and that's how they have to be thinking. They have to win all the games the rest of the season. It's in their hands. So can Arsenal win all those games to make it 18 on the spin? It's highly unlikely. You have to hope that City drop points to Liverpool, but of course I'm going to go for Arsenal. This is what the fans want. This is what you want to be in this situation and hope that this can happen. So I'm going for Arsenal.
You didn't want to make a prediction a minute ago.
Turn into a rallying cry.
It's a rally. Did I say that all out loud? I thought that was all in my head. Did I say that all out loud? No.
Is that your heart or your head saying that?
You know something? People would say it might be my heart saying it, but the numbers are there, Mike. The defensive, the goals, the set pieces, they're top of the league. If you're not going to believe that your team can do it now, then being a fan of a team that's trying to get into the echelons of the league and the top, it's pointless.
See, I think Michael made a really good point about the best team.
Don't try and waste time.
Win.
I'm going to get your prediction.
I'm filibustering. The interesting thing about this is that Arsenal don't, if they're going to win, I don't think they need to focus on being the best team aesthetically, about, you know, in terms of technical brilliance and free-flowing football. They've just got to do the functional things well. Nicolas Jova, who's the most underrated probably member of staff in the Premier League, he's a set-piece coach, and Mikel Arteta goes and sits down and lets him take over at free kicks and corners. But he does the job. You know, he does the job. They've scored the most headed goals in the Premier League as well so far this season. And he is somebody... Sometimes we kind of laugh at clubs that get these guys in to try and find the marginal gains, but he's done that particular job. And I just think they are the small things in what is going to be a race of very, very fine margins that could prove the difference.
So you're saying Arsenal?
Actually.
Are you?
I'm going with Liverpool.
Wow.
Oh, right.
I'll tell you why. I just think they've got the most firepower. They've got Jota to come back, who I think is their best striker. I think, yes, Klopp will regret taking Salah off after what? An hour, 70 minutes of the game against Manchester United. But I think that's to protect him for the really important stage of the season. Yeah, I mean, listen, you know, I defer to you in terms of being a striker for Liverpool and being available in the business end of the season, because when you won the treble in 2001, you played a big part.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, he's really managed Salah back, hasn't he, from a muscle injury, which is, it's important, really important to do that. So he's probably resisted that temptation. And I would add that if you fancy Liverpool, I do think that they've got the easiest run in as well.
Yeah, I've got a good
My heart, of course, says Liverpool. I want Liverpool to win it. I think it'd be the most incredible story, Jurgen Klopp's last season, etc. But I do think that Manchester City are the best team in the world at the moment, and they've proven that. And I can see them just going into overdrive. I think they've got gears left. I think maybe Arsenal and maybe Liverpool are playing absolutely at their peak at the moment, but I think at this time of the season, watch Manchester City go. So my head says Manchester City.
The worry for everybody is that
one. Here we go, all eyes.
But the deciding vote goes to Rachel.
Yeah, we planned this when you weren't about. Not really. Go on, Rachel.
We haven't touched on it. My gut says Arsenal. The one thing we haven't touched on, though, is the impact of Champions League. And I think... I thought about that when I was watching them the other night against Porto, and I thought seeing them progress was that, again, that bit of good feelings, that confidence. Then I do also think, I think being in both competitions is just a huge pressure, a huge weight. Constantly having the games, missing that time in training through the week because you have the midweek fixtures. I think that could play a factor, but I'm going to stick with my gut and say I just feel Arsenal, that could be their year. Just have a feeling.
Yeah, me too.
And also, there's plenty of room to change your mind between now and the end of the season. It's just good to get an idea of where we are as we head into these final 10 games. It's also all to play for in terms of Champions League qualification, especially when neither Villa nor Spurs looked like they were very interested in it at all this weekend. Well, we talked about the race for the title, but in terms of the race for Champions League football, that's looking relatively close. The points total is much wider, or the points difference is much wider, but that's because these teams have been much less consistent than the teams towards the top of the table. So Aston Villa have fourth spot at the moment. They're on 56 points, but Tottenham have played a game less. They're on 53, and then it's Manchester United also played 28, and they're 6 points off Tottenham. There's about a 70% chance, Opta are saying, that fifth place will be a Champions League spot. But they'll all want to make sure, and they'll want to try and aim for fourth place if they can. That might be a bit beyond Manchester United, but fifth certainly isn't as far as they're concerned, because that is the big difference between those top three, where we're saying the slightest slip could cost them the title. The thing is, you expect the next three down to be dropping points and to be a bit inconsistent. This is going to change hands much more.
Yeah, it is. And especially watching Tottenham lose to Fulham like they did. Massive, massive slip up for me from Spurs. I think Man United have got to take something from that in respects of, you know, especially what they've done in the Cup to give them the confidence to maybe finish the season on a high. Like Ten Hag said, you know, it might be the spark to start their season in March, which is such a long time to start the season. But at the same time, that result for me is one that Man United have to try and take advantage of. That Spurs lost that. They've got to win their games now, Manchester United. Can they put a run together? You know, I don't know. You know, what we saw in the FA Cup was unbelievable from their point of view. But I think that it's Manchester United now have to try to find some form to see if they can catch Villa. What, 9 points behind Villa? It's a lot. When you look at a Villa side that, even though they're in the conference as well, Kel, you know, Unai Emery will want to be putting his best teams out in the conference. Yes, they've got some injuries. And you feel that Villa may be the ones that at this stage, it might be the pressure. If you can put them under pressure, you might be able to catch them. But I don't know if Tottenham and Man United are good enough to put a run together to do that.
It's an interesting one because I'm always a big fan of managers who take European competition seriously. And Unai Emery does that with the Europa League. He's won it a number of times with the Europa Conference League. But I wonder if this season that might be the thing that costs them, because they're so stretched. They've got three defenders out with ACLs. We've got a number of other players who got knocks. And it's been a long season for Villa, and they're just kind of...
this is the test for them now.
Here and there, exactly. It's the test.
I think on the injury front, though, I feel like they've handled that really well. A number of players have been out from the start.
Brilliant, the way he's actually not using it as an excuse as
well. Yeah, there's been a lot of players have come in, and, you know, you have to accept that other players don't have the same attributes as maybe ones who've got injured. But I feel like they've stuck to what they believe are the principles, and I think they've done really well. I think a lot of people have almost bet against them. I think there's a lot of people surprised that we're at this point and they're right in there.
But my point is that their squad will be stretched. And it's a question as much as anything. Do you think that he will continue to prioritise both fronts?
I think he will. Especially, see what they've done to Ajax the other day.
Well, this is it. And it gives them a great opportunity in that competition. But if you want to get into the Champions League, acquire higher calibre players, be playing on that stage where nobody believed you would do it at the start of the season, I don't know if the squad is there. They have done unbelievably well. But do they have the numbers that are going to enable them to see it through?
They had such a fantastic start to the season, Aston Villa, didn't they? And they had that brilliant record, particularly at Villa Park. Didn't drop points there to, I think, just before Christmas. And then that record's kind of fallen apart a little bit in terms of their home matches. But they just, both Villa and Tottenham, look vulnerable. If you're in Manchester United's position at the moment, you don't think, well, it's not possible to catch one, if not both of those.
No, you're right. I mean, there will be an opening there for teams below. But you touched on it. I just don't think they're good enough to take it. I don't think Manchester United are good enough to to claw back 9 points against a good Aston Villa team? I don't think so, and I don't think
even with Villa's lack of experience at that end of the league, to, and a manager that will want to do well in the conference, so he's going to use those players.
I mean, it's likely, though, that Manchester United are going to have two more cup games, isn't it? You'd expect them to beat Coventry in the semi-final of the FA Cup, and then they're going to play in a tricky final. You've got Aston Villa that are in the quarterfinals, so the max they can play is another 5 games. So, you know, they might get knocked out in the quarterfinals or the semi-finals, for that matter. So it's hardly like they're going to play another 10 more games than their opponents or anything.
And the thing with Villa as well, is that when you look at their running, and they play, they've got to play some serious teams there.
Yeah.
Well, they've all got to play Liverpool and Arsenal, and Villa and Tottenham have got to play Manchester City as well.
Yeah.
But equally, we're at that stage of the season where we're looking at teams that have got something to play for. And when you look at the way that Burnley, and the performance that Burnley put in at the weekend, suddenly you look at teams at the bottom end of the table. Maybe earlier in the season you would have said that should be straightforward. Now it just looks a little bit more complicated. We'll look at, obviously, the relegation battle in a few minutes. But it's really hard to pick who's got the hardest run in there.
Man United's got the easiest. When you look at it, I know they've got Arsenal.
It's hard to pick, you're fairly clear.
I know. Simply because if they can garner anything from that result the other day, which they should try and do something, even though it was all in, they've put all their chips into that game. You look at that, if they can get something going, you look at that running, and yes, you look at Arsenal there, you know, obviously Liverpool. I think that they've got a very good chance, depending on how... You look at Villa. Villa got City, they got Arsenal, they got Liverpool. They could drop points there.
The other thing to take note from that graphic, I think, is that you look at the points, 56, 53, and then 47. It's a lot of points to make up. Look at the goal difference. That's another point. They've got to go a point ahead of Tottenham or Aston Villa, Manchester United have, because they're not going to gain 17, 18 goals between now and the end of the season.
I think it is a fair
point. So there's an extra point that they've got to get. And the other thing is none of them have got to play each other again. So it's going to be... it's not like... Right, well, we can definitely bank on let's try to beat them. Yeah. You know, Manchester United, if they were going to play Aston Villa still, they'd still be rubbing their hands thinking, right, well, if we beat them, then it's only 6 straight away, but none of them play each other.
So United are a weird team because their run looks good, 9 wins from the last 12, but if you look at a lot of those wins, the other team's been in the game and it's almost been poor finishing, it's been scraping past teams, it's getting a little bit fortunate here and there. And however epic the win over Liverpool was in the FA Cup, they're still a team you can't trust. They still are a team that doesn't have that defensive stability. They've got a mistake in them in every match. And I just look at some of the teams in that graphic, which helpfully is gone now, and I think to myself, as far as United are concerned, I don't trust them to put together the run of wins that is going to reel in Spurs.
Because you can see the other side drop, Spurs in particular, be the one that they're aiming for. You can see them dropping points. Yeah. You just can't see Manchester United being able to capitalise on it. But I don't know, you look at that kind of run of fixtures towards the end of the season, it is 6 points. It's only 10 games.
Yeah.
You know, you could easily put together a good run over 10 games between now and the end of the season. Nobody is in sparkling form between any of the three of those sides, and I don't know. I wonder if maybe it's a bit more open.
You know, maybe you know
than it immediately looks.
It is a bit more open. And what's the difference between these guys and we're talking about the teams that are going for to win the league is that they are dropping points. These guys, they can drop points. So we're trying to guess where they won't drop points rather than where they will get the points. You look at like Man United. If Man United could get someone like, if Martinez comes back in, if Luke Shaw comes back in, that brings another dimension to them. Then all of a sudden you can say, well, yes, they can now build up through the back. We saw that they've got the capability of digging in and getting it done because they've got the forwards with pace. Hoyland's back now. You can see if they can get those players, then you might see something different from Man United.
I'm going back to it. I'm in the Villa. But if you look at the games Villa have at home, and I know their home form has wavered a little bit, but I still think they're very reliable. The Ajax game, I thought they were superb.
Yeah.
The games they have at home are against teams that you would expect them to win. And I think if they can, you know, if they get points, Wolves, Brentford, Bournemouth, Chelsea would be tricky, but if they can get those first three, then I think they'll have that momentum. You know, the last one is Liverpool, which of course will be hard, but if you can get 4 to 5 home wins, I think that's going to put them very, very close to
finishing the Champions League places and reach an FA Cup final, potentially win the FA Cup final, if it's against Manchester City, even more so. What do we think of Erik ten Hag's chances over the summer of being Manchester United manager by the start of next season?
Well, I don't think you could not give it to him because of what he's achieved. But then I was thinking about football history. It's full of managers who have done the job and still been replaced. Claudio Ranieri, when he was at Chelsea, managed to get them into the Champions League, and they still said, we're bringing in Jose Mourinho. Louis van Gaal in 2016 won the FA Cup. He was celebrating on the pitch with, over Crystal Palace, of course, and he got the call saying that Jose Mourinho was going to get his job. Mark Hughes and Manuel Pellegrini at Manchester City both were basically setting the table for Pep Guardiola to come along, and they both won the Premier League. So I think even if he does manage to achieve his objectives, they don't have an identity. I don't think the man management is... I mean, you guys can speak to all of that kind of thing in terms of the impact he's having on the dressing room, with the culture that inspires players to run through brick walls. I don't think he stays.
You know what, Kels? I think he has to. He has to try and make a good charge for fourth or win the FA Cup. I think if he comes in the summer, especially with Jim Ratcliffe saying it's important to get the Champions League, they don't get that and they don't win the cup, I can't see how they would want to say, let's go with him again. I can't.
It is going to be tough for them with that 6-point gap to overhaul. But we tried to make a case there for Manchester United catching up with Tottenham in particular, possibly, although even less likely, Aston Villa. At the bottom of the table, it's all change after this weekend. Some really big results and maybe a few changed preconceptions. All about the bottom of the table. Big results for Burnley, a win for them, a first of this calendar year. And then that late equaliser for Luton to earn them a point. Just even more importantly, keep Nottingham Forest within touching distance, just 3 points between them. And then with Everton on 25 points as well, Brentford with that defeat by Burnley being dragged into that relegation battle. It's looking closer than it has done at various stages this season. At one point, Darren, it looked as though relegation battle was going to be done very early. Now it's looking even closer. And there are still some decisions to be made about a couple of those teams.
There are indeed. And one could be pivotal to the race to stay up, because our reporters are telling us at the Daily Mirror that Nottingham Forest are likely to be deducted 4 points for their breach of profit and sustainability rules. That would take them into the bottom three. Given that they're winless in their last 10 games, you then start to worry about their Premier League future. Of course, it hasn't been confirmed as yet, but our colleagues have it on good authority that that is going to be the case.
I think that if that's the case, I think that Luton might do it. I think Luton might get out of that simply because they've got something. I think everybody kind of loves them. And I think... And my missus loves Rob Edwards. It's really... I love Rob Edwards. Yeah. And now I'm looking at him and I'm kind of jealous of him a bit, because my missus loves him so much. But I really love him. I love how emotional he is. I love how they do not give up. And you know, when you're watching a relegation fight, there's always a team that's in it.
Yes.
That you can see that they are fighting. They're all together. Luton are that team this year. Because you have to look at Sheffield United, and I know that Burnley won the other day for first game in 10, first win in 10 or something like that. But you do feel like they've gone. You do have to look at those two and feel there's one more place. And I think that Luton might save themselves. I'm hoping that they can.
I think you're right in the so much as Luton always find a way to salvage a point. And obviously, Jake Berry coming on, first player to score in all four divisions for Luton.
Wow.
But Forest almost always seem to find a way either to lose or to drop points. And I just think that tailspin of bad decision-making, poor form... it's a personal opinion, but I think the continued arguing around referees is starting to cost them and create a culture of blaming other people rather than taking responsibility. I think it's a problem for them.
Luton are so interesting because, as you said, there's a real emotion behind what they're trying to do. And while we talk about that maybe not being so helpful at the top of the table, often it can bring in that sort of fighting spirit at the bottom. And they've had such a difficult season, even going back to last season's playoff final where Tom Lockyer collapsed and then recovered to be able to play for them again. He collapsed again in the game against Bournemouth earlier in the season when they had the replay in midweek. Luton were 3-0 up, went on to lose that 4-3 to Bournemouth. So it puts even more on that late equaliser that they got at the weekend against Nottingham Forest when Luke Berry came on and, and, as you said, became the first player to score in all four divisions for them.
Everybody loves the underdog, and I think coming into this season, some of the things you've mentioned there, Kelly, it's they were the underdog. I think most people would have them as rock bottom, as the whipping boys in the division. And I think everybody has admired the way they've gone about it. You know, their heart on their sleeve. They've had some big disappointments and some big challenges to overcome. And they haven't spent a lot of money. And I just think that everybody can really relate to what they're doing and what they are. And I think everybody's behind them in many ways. I mean, it would be nice as well. I often, you know, when three teams come up and all three of them go back down, it feels sort of maybe there's a big gap bridge in between the Premier League and the Championship. So it would be nice to give all the teams that come up a little bit of hope that they can stay on, stay up as well. And with players like Luton, I've got, with all due respect to them, they wouldn't have been expected to be Premier League players. And all of a sudden, they look great. And
they certainly didn't plan for being in the Premier League this season. And they've certainly not necessarily planned, or they've got contingency plans in place in case of relegation, because they know that they've been promoted maybe a bit earlier, as you say, than they would have expected. But for Burnley, they were absolutely flying at the top of the Championship, been used to winning every game, week in, week out, dictating the style of play. Vincent Kompany said they've come to the Premier League. Obviously, they're coping with losing more often than not in those games, but also they're not able to impose the way they want to play on games. But I just wonder, maybe that result at the weekend might suggest that there's more of a chance than we thought they might have.
I think it'll certainly go a long way for them. They, you know, they came out, they were such a, you know, formidable team last year. They got into that habit of winning game after game, the impact that can then have, a lot of those players then getting the chance to come up and play in the Premier League. You then have the total opposite of that, the confidence that sort of has on the players. It is tough. They then had to try, they tried so long to not change their identity. They tried to stick to what they believed was the way to play. They've sort of, I think they're just starting to come out the back of that. You're starting to feel that resilience of, we need to be tough to beat. I think it's a huge uphill battle for them, but I do think the fact they did get those 3 points will be enormous for them. But you know, to try and get out of where they are will be so, so hard.
I think this is why when Burnley came up, and they came up with Vincent and Vincent Kompany, and he's, you know, he's so loved. He's an icon. He's brilliant. He's one of our Premier League Hall of Famers. And, you know, the way they came up in such style. And, you know, everybody was, all the emphasis was on how they play, and he's going to come, he's going to play this way. What happens is that you come into the Premier League, and you soon find after a while, once you're worked out, you have to have the plan B. You have to have the resilience of what a Luton have got. Mm. You know what I mean? Luton have not come here and they're uncompromising in the way they play, and they're going to make it very difficult for you. They'll try and play it through with Ross Barkley, or they'll get it directly up to Morris. They get the most crosses in the box. They're putting teams under pressure, especially at the Kenny. They're doing what they what they know and what's been successful for them. And it's probably what's going to save them in the end. I think it's taken so much time. When you look back at Burnley's goals, the goals they concede, all because of playing out and losing the ball in certain places and people closing them down. And I think they've taken so long to change that. And I think it might cost them in the end.
And it's weird, actually, because, as you say, Vincent hasn't had that much criticism because he's so loved. Actually, I think that might have been counterproductive. Because had he had that criticism, he might have been a bit more pragmatic rather than thinking, no, we're going to continue to play it the way we play. Because I think it's a myth that when you hear it being said about any given manager, he plays football the right way. The right way is winning football.
Winning, thank
you. That's what you play football for. You can talk about beautiful football and you can talk about easy on the eye. But if you manage to win things, you achieve your objectives.
And certainly in terms of professional football, it's not about going out and playing in the park. This is all about getting the results. Just a word on teams who are maybe on the edges of this. Brentford have very much been dragged into it from that result at the weekend. Everton deducted points, had some of them returned, potentially could lose more points so far this season. As you were saying, your reporters are telling you it's going to be four for Nottingham Forest. So that would sort of mean that they would drop into the relegation places. But just a word, Darren, on those two sides in Brentford and Everton, who might yet be dragged further into this relegation battle?
Yeah, the worry for Everton, they're winless in their last 10 now, and I just can't see where they're going to get that confidence that will help them to get out of it. Whereas Brentford, I still think they've got that triumvirate up front of Wissa, Maupay and Tony, yes. And I think that could help them to scrap their way, shoot their way to safety. I think it could well be either Everton or Forest find themselves.
Look at that, yeah. You look
and
at
Burma back for Brentford is because he came back at the weekend. That could be big for them. Yeah, they really miss him when they don't have him available. Sorry, Wrighty.
No, I was just going to say when you look at Luton's home games, Bournemouth and Brentford, Everton and Fulham, and how Luton are playing down there, you can see them getting points out of that.
Yeah.
You look at Everton's and they've got to play teams in and around them, massive games. Then they've got Arsenal in the last day of the season away, I remember. They had Arsenal away when Arsenal won the league in 98. That's coincidence. Anyway, you know, so if they haven't got it done by then, you know what I mean? That you can't see them going to an Arsenal side who might still need something to win the league and they might need something to stay in the league. Mm. You have to fancy Arsenal there. I really do feel for Everton. Obviously, Forest, with what's happening with the points. Mm. But like I think Everton and Forest as well. I do.
It is so, so close. Wrighty, back again in a couple of weeks' time after the big game against Manchester City. It's a long time to wait when there's an international break between now and then, isn't it?
I know, but we're top all that time, so we
Well, that's all right. When we get to the end of the season, we'll say, and Arsenal were top for X number of days.
See how she's trolling?
Michael, lovely to see you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rachel, and thank you to Darren as well for coming in. The run-in is just about to get underway. As soon as we're done with this international break, the Premier League will be back. It's all to be decided at the top of the table in terms of European qualification and in terms of who stays in the Premier League come next season. We'll see you next time.